Today I will talk about X-ray spectroscopy in neutron star LOMAS X-ray binaries. These are compact systems, I mean with relatively low orbital period, in which the neutron star has a quite weak magnetic field, so the disk can really approach the neutron star surface. So we see nice phenomenology like kilohertz QPOs. That means quasi-coherent oscillations at frequency up to kilohertz. Type 1 X-ray bursts from the neutron star surface, where sometimes you can detect quasi-coherent oscillations at the spin frequency of the neutron star. And also most of these systems are transient and they spend most of the time in a quiescent state with a quite low X-ray luminosity, and then they go into outburst with the variation in luminosity up to a factor 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6. These sources, they also show spectral state transitions, in the sense that you can find them in a soft spectral state and in a hard spectral state. And these are the components we usually use to fit these spectra that are soft black body components, and power law with exponential cutoff or thermal Comptonization component. When the source switches from the soft to the high state to the hard state, you can see that the cutoff of the Comptonization increases a lot, up to more than 100 kV. And also we find signatures of a reflection component most importantly, iron emission line at these energies. You know that these line profiles are very useful to get information on the inner accretion flow close to the compact object, since the line profile depends on this parameter, the ionization parameter and the element abundance in the inner part of the disk, the emissivity index in the disk, disk inclination, and also from the inner and outer radii of the disk. So we can have with these systems using disk line profiles information on the system that are inaccessible with other ways. But the iron line is not the only feature that you find from a reflection of a Comptonization spectrum on an accretion disk, because you also have a Compton scattered continuum that you see like a Compton bump in your spectrum, and also other low energy features from lighter elements and also absorption edges. Here you can see a compilation of the iron line profiles that have been detected in low mass X-ray binaries, neutron star low mass X-ray binaries from Suzaku and XMM. You see Suzaku in black, SMM in red, and here you can find also some references on this, on the work that's been done on these sources. But I go to more recent claims. In particular, this is a well-known low-mass X-ray binary that is 1728. In this case, we had an XMM observation during a hard state. The source was not so bright, so we didn't have, fortunately, pile up or other problems. And in this case, we find a broad iron line that is better fitted by a disk line profile than a Gaussian profile. You can see here the probability of chance improvement of the fit, 10 to the minus 4, that we also checked with the Monte Carlo simulation. And we derive parameters of the inner accretion disk, and in particular the inner radius that is relatively large, more than 25 kilometers, and the inclination of the system. This is another, high statistic case, bright low mass X-ray binaries, GX 3 plus 1, where we detect not only very well-defined iron line profile, but also other broad low energy lines from argon and calcium. And also in this case, we have a statistically significant detection of the asymmetry of the line, since we have a probability of chance improvement of 10 to the minus 15 if we use a disk line instead of a Gaussian. And also in this case, we can calculate very well constrained parameters for the inner accretion disk. These are accreting millisecond pulse because some of these, usually the magnetic field of the neutron star in Lomas X-ray bias is not dynamically important, it's quite weak, but sometimes it is weak but can also channel the matter flow towards the polar cap and give millisecond pulsation because these sources are quite fast. This is one of them with a period of 4 milliseconds. And in this case, the millisecond pulsars are usually found in a hard state, they are transient. We find the broad iron line profile together with the Compton bump around 30 kV. Also in this case, we can derive the parameters of the inner accretion disk. This is another accreting millisecond pulsar. This is a unique object since it is an X-ray and radio millisecond pulsar. It was recently published on Nature by Alessandro Papito. And in this case, we have two XMM observations. In both cases, we see broad iron line. And also in this case, we can model the line with disk line and get inner parameters for the disk. In particular, the inner radius of the disk is around 36 kilometers from the iron line, and this is very well compatible with what we derive from the black body component coming from the disk in this source. Of course, in these cases, I'm not claiming that the line is asymmetric. In this case, a Gaussian fit is it can be also be acceptable, but still using the line is broad, using this line, we can derive these parameters. This is another interesting case, another accreting millisecond pulse, where we find broad iron line together with a very strong and broad complex emission line around the 1 kV that seems to be confirmed also with the RGS. And this is probably due to a blending of lines from the iron L shell and neon 910. And also in this case, we have well-constrained parameters for the accretion disk. You see the inner radius is always between 25 and 50 kilometers, and the inclination angle are around 30 degrees. This is another, the 11 Hertz pulse in terms of 5, where this is a Chandra observation, where it was observed that broad iron line and on top two absorption feature from highly ionized hydrogen and helium-like iron. So this is also evidence of a strong wind in a high inclined source. So this is to show you what we can do, I mean, with these sources, thanks to the very good statistics we have. And this is also Cerex-1 observed by NOSTAR. This is a recent observation. You can see a very nice line profile that confirms the one that was already observed by XMM and Suzaku. And here you can see the parameters. In this case, we have a 30 kilosecond observation, and we have a quite steep emissivity index. The authors can constrain also, Miller et al. Can constrain also the spin parameter of the neutron star, that is 0.17. We don't know the spin, unfortunately, of this source, but maybe in the future we can prove or disprove this prediction. And we have an inner radius of the disk that is at 1.8, the radius of the innermost stable circular orbit. And this is the infrared inclination of the source. And in this case, NOSTAR is also able to detect significant, statistical significant Compton bump above 10 kV. I will spend some more words on this source. That is one that I have studied more in detail. This is a bright Lomas X-ray binary 1705 and was observed for 25 kiloseconds by XMM, obtaining this really beautiful spectrum. You can see that the error bars on the point are not visible because they are covered by the model. And these are the model components that we used for the spectral fitting. You see that we detect more than one discrete feature, the iron line and also the low energy lines. And these are the final residuals of the fit. And you can see here the line profiles. So there is a very nice line profile from iron 25. This is a broad iron edge. And also you can see emission lines from sulfur, argon, calcium. All these elements are ionized, and in particular the lighter one, the light sulfur and argon are in the hydrogen-like state, and the calcium and fer and iron are in the helium-like state. And this is the detail of the iron line profile that is asymmetric. It's at 6.7 and is perfectly fitted by a disk line, as you can see in this unfolded spectrum. In particular, the probability of chance improvement when we use a disk line instead of a Gaussian is around 10 to the minus 11, so statistically significant. These are the parameters we get from the iron line profile fitting. These are the energy of the line, and that means that the ionization parameter is quite high. This is the inner radius of the disk, the inclination angle of the system, of the inner accretion disk, and look at the errors. They are really small. We can also constrain the emissivity index, and we have also constrained the outer radius of the disk. I think this is important. I mean, it's important to fit all the parameters of the smearing component, because if you arbitrarily fix one of them, usually the outer radius is fixed, then you constrain the other parameters, especially if you have these statistics. And these are the results of the fit of all the low energy features that we detect in the spectrum. We just used the same smearing parameters for all of them, and we find a very good fit. You can see that all the energies that we measure are perfectly compatible with the rest frame energy of these lines. So these are the smearing parameters, and also the iron edge appears to be slightly redshifted and broad, and is compatible with coming from the same emission region of the iron line. This is a Suzaku's observation of the 1705 that also shows a broad iron line profile, and these are the parameters obtained by Kaket et al. Reis et al. They obtain this inner radius of the disk and inclination angle that are compatible with the value we find. They also use the broadband reflection model to fit this spectrum that also include Compton broadening that is quite strong for ionized spectrum. Nevertheless, they still need to add to the spectrum the relativistic smearing of the line. And you may ask if this data can be affected by pile-up or other instrumental problems, since we have a lot of statistics. So we have to deal with these problems. And to understand it better, we have extracted data from the old CCD using the old PN statistics, or excluding the central row, or excluding up to 7 central rows in the CCD. That means rejecting 90% of the source count. And we obtain these residuals, black, red, and green, respectively. And you can see that in any case, the residuals are always very similar to each other. So there is no clear instrumental effect, at least due to pile up in this case. With the green set of data, we obtain these parameters for the iron line. You see the errors are larger than before, but still values are more or less compatible with what we obtain with the whole statistics. In this case, you should be careful, because if you eliminate the 7 central rows from the CCD, you have to deal with the calibration problems in the wings of the point spread function in the XMM, in PN. So I think it should be considered with caveat. And this is also Beppo-Sachs' result in 2007 from the same source. Also in that case, this Klein profile was preferred to a Gaussian profile with the FTS probability of chance improvement around 10 to the minus 5. And this was these are the parameters we got at that time. And you can compare these parameters with the XMM of the results, and you can see that are really compatible to each other, including the radius of the black body component that is not very different from we get from for the inner radius of the disk from the disk line component. And these are the residuals of the XMM PN and Beppo-Sachs seen together. Of course, you can see that the line profile is similar in the two cases. These differences, normalization, is due to the fact that these are residuals in units of sigma, and of course sigma in the two instruments are different. You can see in the inset the ratio with respect to the best fit continuum model, and you see again that the two profiles are very similar to each other. So we decided to fit together the XMM and the Beppo-Sachs observation. They are not simultaneous, but still they are in the same state, that is a soft state, and we get a very good fit with these residuals. This is the unfolded model, so we fit the reflection component with the self-consistent reflection model, but we had to add the argon and calcium lines that are not included in the model. And we did the same, fitting together XMM and Beppo-Sachs in the hard state, again obtaining a very good fit with the self-consistent broadband reflection model. These are the parameters in the soft state. So you see that all the parameters in the Beppo-Sachs, for the Beppo-Sachs spectra, were kept to fixed to those used for the X-ray spectrum, except for a few for which we have very tiny differences. And the same for the hard state, in which we significantly detect also a Compton bump component with probability of chance improvement that is so low, 10 to the minus 38. And we can compare the parameters in the soft and the hard state and see that the electron temperature, as we expect, increases a lot from the soft to the hard state. On the other hand, the ionization parameter decreases from the soft to the hard state. And this is the inner radius of the disk we get for the reflection component that is that seems to be a little bit larger for the hard in the hard state than in the soft state. This is a 100 kilosecond Suzaku observation of 1705 in the hard state. Again, we obtain a very nice spectrum where we can see residuals at the argon line, the iron line, and this is a residual due to the Compton bump, so we can fit again the spectrum with the broadband reflection component, obtaining a very good fit. And again, we can compare the parameters of the Suzaku observation in the hard state with the XMM observation in the soft state. And again, we find that the electron temperature, of course, increases going from the soft state to the hard state. The ionization parameters decreases going from the soft state to the hard state, while the smearing parameters of the reflection component are quite similar in the two states. This is the emissivity index, the inclination, the outer radius of the disk, and the inner radius of the disk. Of course, in the hard state, we have less statistics because the source is less bright, but still we have very nice agreement in the two cases. This is another millisecond pulsar, the first discovered millisecond pulsar, SAR-J1808, and this is a 60 kilosecond XMM spectrum of the source. This is a transient, and usually it stays always in a hard state, so we have fitted the spectrum with these spectral components. This is the iron line profile. In this case, we don't have a strong indication that the line is asymmetric, in the sense it can be fitted also with a Gaussian line, a Gaussian model. But we also, what the line is broad. You see here a sigma of 1.1 kV, and we also detect the iron edge. And this is a comparison of with the Suzaku spectrum obtained the day after the XMM observation. So you see the two instruments are in agreement with each other. We can calculate from the width of the line, in this case the inner radius of the disk, it is around 20 kilometers. These are in particular from 12 to 26 kilometers, and this our upper limit is less than the rotation radius in the source. That means that the inner radius we measure from the disk line fits exactly the small region between the surface of the neutron star and the co-rotation radius where accretion is possible for a pulsar. We also measured the outer radius of the disk from the reflection component. We find quite small value. I don't know if this is indeed reliable since we don't have a statistical significance that the line is asymmetric in this case, but we can speculate that in this source, that is a transient, was observed by XMM like 10 days after the beginning of the outburst during the decay, we can speculate that the inner disk is truncated both in the inner part of the because of the magnetic field of the neutron star and in the outer part, maybe because the outburst was going to its end and the disk didn't receive any more mass from the companion star. And if we go towards the future, we can see how Athena Plus will see the line profile in 1705. So you see that here we have a much better energy resolution than XMM. So you can see, we will maybe see the double peaked profile that is typical of Keplerian disk, of a line emitted by a Keplerian disk. And this is what we get if we fit this profile with a Gaussian. And of course you can see that the fit is not acceptable. It's not a good approximation anymore. But, and this is what we would observe for 1705 with LOFT in only 10 kiloseconds observation. The one before was 60 kiloseconds. So in only 10 kiloseconds we observe this very nice broadband spectrum, iron line, the other low energy lines. And of course we cannot fit with this feature with a Gaussian. We obtain this probability of chance improvement if we use a disk line instead of a Gaussian in this very nice LOFT spectrum. And with 60 kiloseconds of LOFT, we would also constrain variation of the emissivity disk index along the disk radius. This is a simulation with LOFT, 10 kiloseconds LOFT observation each of SAX-J1808. In the hypothesis that indeed the outer radius of the disk changes during the outburst, going from a maximum value to a minimum value, and so we can see how the line profile will change along the outburst. And this is another simulation of 100 seconds of SCOAX-1, the brightest X-ray source in the sky. You can see that line profile is very, it's at 60 sigma above the continuum, so very strong. And in this simulation, we vary the inner radius of the disk, and we see how the line profile varies. But We can also observe Kira's QPOs with Loft simultaneous to the line profile in so small time scales. So we can derive the inner radius of the disk from the iron line fitting that is proportional to the gravitational radius. And this factor K comes from the fit, of course. And we can also derive the inner radius that we can infer from the frequency of the Kirtz QPOs in the hypothesis that they are Keplerian frequency. We can couple these two observations and derive the mass of the neutron star as a function of the frequency of the Kirtz QPO and this parameter K. So we can get not only a measure of the inner radius of the disk, which constrains also the radius of the neutron star surface, but also an estimation of the mass of the neutron star. And the uncertainty of this estimation comes mainly on the K, from the K factor that we can determine with this simulation with uncertainty of about 5%. This means that we can have an uncertainty of about 10% of the neutron star mass. In principle, we can measure the neutron star mass with an uncertainty of 0.1 solar masses. So these are my conclusions. There is a lot to learn on these sources because we can get advantage from the high statistics of these sources, but to do that we really need good compatibility instruments with good time and spectral resolution. And of course, we have to deal with, we have to contain any systematics on the instrument in order to exploit all the statistics in this source. And of course, we really need complete self-consistent reflection model, including all the lines that we observe in the spectrum and often are not included in the model. So this is my final conclusion. And if I can spend a couple of words for the reclame of this Cefalù workshop that we will done in 2014, in June 2014. This is the title of the workshop. So these are the topics, and please look at our web page. Thank you very much.